Good morning, Harry.
Good morning, Frank.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Judy. Good morning. Welcome to worship, everyone who is sitting in the sanctuary and those who are live streaming today. It's a great day to worship, as is every day. The Bible always reminds us that this day is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. You know, if it was weather like this about an hour ago, we could have met outside, which was our plan, but it was still misting not too long before the service, and rain still dripping from the trees out in the park, and so we thought it was best just to meet in here. So we haven't had much luck with our last couple of outdoor service plans. The air conditioner unit in the sanctuary is not working. The air conditioner units in the other parts of the building are, but there was extensive damage we have figured out in the sanctuary units. And the more it is repaired, the more they put in new parts, the more they find out more panels and boards have been blown. Evidently, a couple weeks ago, there was some kind of voltage spike. Usually it trips out when that happens, and then I just reset it. But this time, something happened where it created a lot and extensive damage. So probably no air conditioning for the rest of the year here. And an insurance claim is being filed because do you put in parts that'll keep getting more and more expensive, or do you just replace the whole unit? So that's the update on the sanctuary air conditioning. So good thing it's not June, right? Rally Day is just 2 weeks away, and I know from Denise that we still need some part-time teachers, correct? And so we're still looking for individuals of any age who love kids and want to share God's story with them, and there's good support for our teachers and helpers as well. So if God is putting it into your heart, or if you know someone else who would enjoy doing that and working with another teacher every other Sunday or whatever the case might be, please let Denise know here in the church office. Offering plates today are in the narthex. They won't be passed. Thank you for what you give to the congregation here at Trinity. And Hollis, if that air conditioner, if that fan isn't turned on up there, over by Evan, if it's on, okay, great, it's on. You'll need that up in the balcony. I want to thank Judy and Harry for leading music today, Frank for reading our lessons. Again, everybody, welcome to church. Let's stand and sing our gathering hymn, hymn 679. The words in the bulletin, remember this was made thinking it would be outside, pretty small here, and so you might want to, if you want bigger words, just turn to hymn number 679, verses 1 and 3.
Fruit of all creation, thanks be to God. For these gifts to every nation, thanks be to God. For the plowing, sowing, reaping, silent growth while we are sleeping. Future needs in earth safekeeping, thanks be to God. For the harvest of the Spirit, thanks be to God. For the good we all inherit, thanks be to God. For the wonders that astound us, for the truths that still confound us, most of all that love has found us, thanks be to God.
I'll begin with the words of confession and forgiveness, and the congregational response is printed in your bulletin. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So let's take a moment of silence as we bring our sins and our burdens to the Lord. Together we confess. We confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated as we sing verses 1 and 4 of hymn 561.
Actually, the hymn number is 879.
That sounds good too.
Thank you, Harry. 879, if you are looking in your books.
Skies, for the love which from our birth over and around us lies, Christ our Lord, to thee we raise this our sacrifice of praise. For the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild, Christ our God, to thee we raise this our sacrifice of praise.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. O God, our strength, without you we are weak and wayward creatures. Protect us from all dangers that attack us from the outside, and cleanse us from all evil that arises from within ourselves, that we may be preserved through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
First lesson is from Deuteronomy chapter 4. So now, Israel, give heed to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to observe, so that you may live to enter and occupy the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving to you. You must neither add anything to what I command you, nor take away anything from it, but keep the commandments of the Lord your God with which I am charging you. You must observe them diligently, for this will show your wisdom and discernment to the peoples, who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, "Surely this great nation is wise and discerning people, for what other great nation has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is whenever we call to him?" And what other great nation has statutes and ordinances as just as this entire law that I am setting before you today? But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all of the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. We'll read Psalm 15 responsively. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide upon your holy hill?
Those who lead a blameless life and do what is right, to speak truth from their hearts.
They do not slander with the tongue. They do no evil to their friends. They do not cast discredit upon a neighbor.
In their sight, the wicked are rejected, but they honor those who fear the Lord. They have sworn upon their health and do not take back their word.
They do not give their money in hope of gain, nor do they take bribes against the innocent. Those who do these things shall never be overthrown. Second lesson comes from James chapter 1. Every generous act of giving with every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creations, creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget what they were like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for the orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Frank. I'd like to invite the kids up for the children's lesson. Come on up. All right. Good morning. I would like to talk about rules. We all like rules, right? What's a rule? What's a rule? Okay, that's a good example. In order to get a toy, it's really important to listen to mom. Mm-hmm. What's another rule that you know of? Do you have other rules in your house?
I do.
What?
You do help mom clean things, then clean up things.
Clean up, good. Do you have a rule in your house to clean up your bedroom?
I do.
Yeah, do you do a pretty good job of cleaning up your bedroom? Oh, there's other rules too. I remember a rule in my house that after supper, we couldn't just go away to the living room or to our bedroom or to play outside. Guess what we had to do before we left the table? Yeah, first we had to eat all of our food, and then we had to help clear the table. Yeah, so we have rules. Oh, there's rules in school too. Can you think of a rule that's in school?
I know.
Yeah.
You have to go to your teacher to do what?
Okay. Yeah, you just can't do whatever you want in school. the teacher's in charge, right? So you go up to the teacher, and the teacher will help you to do what needs to be done that day. Oh, I bet at school you can run through the hallways and scream all you want, right? No, right? You can't. No, that's a rule. No running in the hallways, no screaming, you know, keep your voices normal. Oh, there are lots of rules. If you come up, if you're in the car with your mom and dad, and you see a sign that has, it's red, and it has eight sides on it, what should the car be doing? Yeah, slowing down and then stop. That's a rule. Why do we have rules, do you think? Why? Just to take away all of our fun? I didn't think it was fun to clean my bedroom. I don't always think it's fun to stop for stop signs either. I had a police officer tell me that one time that I have to stop a complete stop. And that was just right at the corner of Memorial Park here in town. I was embarrassed. Well, rules are there to help us, right? Not to take the fun away. Rules are there so that people can all be respected and get along and to keep people healthy. Even keeping a clean bedroom keeps the room more clean, and that means more healthy for you, and then it's a lot easier for you to walk through the room and not trip on a toy and things like that. Keeps us safe. Rules keep us safe. That's right. Sometimes rules, we always wonder, why is that a rule? It doesn't seem like it should be a rule. And we think about it. Who says that should be a rule? And Jesus had that happen to him one time. And we're going to hear it in the gospel lesson. Back in Jesus' day, it was important to wash hands like we do today. But there was a rule back in Jesus' day where you had to wash your hands in a certain way. First of all, they didn't have a water faucet, so just like a pitcher of water. First, they would hold their hand up like this and pour water over their hands like this. That was a rule. And then they had to put their fingers downward and pour water from their elbows down to their fingertips. And when you're drying your hand, you start up and you go all the way down to the last fingertip. If you just did like this, that'd be breaking the rule. Jesus thought to himself, why is washing your hands like that such a big rule? And the reason why it was a problem is that it made people get mad at each other because people weren't doing it right. And Jesus said, maybe there's a better rule. And a good rule is one that protects you and makes you safe and makes you to love one another and God.
Oh, I know.
Yeah?
If you throw candy up in the air, you can't eat it.
If you do what? If you drop candy on the ground, you should throw it away, of course. There's a rule in my family called the 5-second rule. But thanks, kids, for coming up. You can go back to your seats. Remember to follow the rules, especially when they help you to love your parents and everybody else and God. I invite us all to stand and let's sing, Lord, Let My Heart Be Good Soil.
Lord, let my heart be good soil, open to the seed of your word. Lord, let my heart be good soil, where love can grow and peace is understood. When my heart is hard, break the stone away. When my heart is cold, warm it with the day. When my heart is lost, lead me on your way. Lord, let my heart be good soil.
The Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions they observe, the washing of cups and pots and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" Jesus said to them, "Oh, Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites. As it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is written from the human heart that evil intentions come, like fornication, theft, and murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these things come from within, and they are what defile a person." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this gathering today as we come and do what we were created to do, and that is worship you. So, Lord, we glorify you today. We put our needs second for a while as we listen to what you have to say to us, as you edify and nurture us through music, through your word, and through the fellowship of being with each other. Bless us with your spirit, we pray. Amen. Grace and peace to you all through our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, when you came here today, how did you decide where to sit? I mean, some of you have confused me. You got a couple in the back there, you got some folks that don't normally sit in the balcony. It kind of throws me off a little bit. I mean, how am I supposed to look at you and preach when you're sitting in places that you don't normally sit? But 99% of you are in your typical spots. Oh, maybe you've moved up a pew in the last few months or behind because of these ropes that are in the way that kind of keep us distanced. But pretty much of the time, we like to be in the rows and the spots that we've always sat. Even if we have to get here a half an hour early, by George, we want to be in that spot. Imagine coming to church one day and someone is in your spot. And you say to your wife, "Oh, look, Joyce, can you believe these people are sitting in our spot?" Your heart starts to race and you look around wondering what to do. And then you ask yourself, what? Do I go upstairs and sit on the balcony with those other crazy people? I think not. And so you take a deep breath and then you sit in the next open spot. Until that is, people are looking at you and you realize that you've sat in their spot and you have to move all the insanity. Oh, we Lutherans have traditions, and one of those traditions is don't sit in somebody else's spot. Well, there are traditions in our homes and in our churches. Some traditions are good, and some traditions are not so good. I served a church once, my first parish, and I've told this story before. I remember we wanted more people during the summertime to be on the main floor. The balcony was almost as big as the main floor. And we would have Sundays where 80% of the people would be sitting in the balcony. And so what we did, what any logical person would do, we roped off the balcony with a sign that said, "Please sit on the main floor." Ushers told me afterwards that people came and looked at it and saw that it was roped off, the seats to the balcony, and they just went outside and went home. Didn't even stay for church. It's a tradition. I sit where I always sit. Traditions guide our thinking in many ways, especially with regards to religion. Remember this, well, we still call it this, the new red hymnal. I guess it's not technically red. What do we call it? Some other color. But it's close to red. And I remember when this started, 15 years ago. Many people had a hard time accepting this because it was new. It was new, and by George, we liked the green hymnal. Why would they change it and then put different songs and exclude other songs? And well, I remember when this came out, people were so upset because it was replacing the old red hymnal, which everybody loved. Oh, it took a few years to get used to this green one, but then again, this red one replaced the black one, and by George, you know, how are we supposed to deal with all of this change in church? I remember Martin Luther, he battled a lot of traditions that just didn't make sense. Most of them are resisting change, and the hesitation with tradition is because of resisting change. Martin Luther battled some of these stale traditions in the 16th century. Most of the hymns that were sung in churches back then were old tunes, and they were sung only by the choir or professional singers. It was not acceptable for the congregation, for the normal people attending worship, to sing. As a matter of fact, they sang most of their songs in Latin, which the German people, the ordinary person, couldn't understand anyway. And Martin Luther thought, what a terrible tradition, where we sing hymns that people don't even understand. More people have to be involved. Well, Luther wrote new hymns for the congregation so that they could sing together. One was A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. And evidently, that tune was a bar tune that Martin Luther would hum when he'd be drinking in the bar with his friends. Well, it wasn't too surprising that Martin Luther drank beer. He liked beer. As a matter of fact, his wife owned a brewery right out of their house. And so that was a source of income for them. But Martin Luther enjoyed drinking with his friends. Well, when people heard that, most church critics, when they discovered what Martin Luther was doing, writing new hymns, they said, "You can't do this. You'll destroy their faith. We've always done it this way. You can't change it." Oh, tradition. It's hard to challenge or change tradition. It's the way we've always done it, we say. But sometimes we really don't know why these traditions develop. I'll share this story with you. It's an oldie but goodie. We've heard it before, but it just goes to show sometimes how traditions keep us from really understanding where they came from, and maybe we realize they don't help us much today. Once there was two newlyweds, and they were preparing in their new home their first baked ham for dinner. Well, after unwrapping the meat and setting it on the cutting board, the wife took a butcher knife and chopped off both ends of the ham and threw those two ends in the garbage. "Wait a minute," said the mystified husband. "Why did you do that? Why did you cut off the edges of the ham and throw that good meat into the garbage?" "Well, I don't know," she said. "That's what my mother always did. But maybe it helps out to bring the flavor." Unsatisfied with the answer, the husband called his mother-in-law and asked, "Can you tell me, why did you cut two ends off a ham before you cooked it?" "Well," said the mother, "I'm not sure why. That's the way my mother did her ham. And it was always delicious. Maybe it helped to cook faster that way." Well, as soon as he hung up, of course, he called his wife's grandmother. "Grandma, we have a very important question for you. Can you tell us why you cut off the ends of the ham before you cook it? Is it to bring out the flavor? Is it to cook it faster?" And the grandmother said in her thin, quiet voice, she said, "Oh, my dear, I cut the ends off the ham so that it can fit into my pan." Tradition. And sometimes we do things and it just doesn't make sense anymore. I think it's always good to double check our traditions now and then. If traditions bring us meaning and joy, they're great. But if traditions and rules load us down, make us stale, make us judgmental of other people, perhaps it's time to change. When we think of religion, I think not all religious traditions are good. One example is what Jesus experienced in the gospel lesson. I talked about the children's lesson. Jesus was a little put off by this cleanliness tradition of washing your hands. Now, he wasn't against washing hands. It's just the attitude that came with it with regards to how you wash your hands. Well, the ritual of washing hands, it's great to keep us clean, but it's not great if it affords us energy to judge other people from doing it the wrong way. You know, when we met in our Tuesday morning Bible study this past week, we talked about how we are reading it differently this year, because with COVID and such, our minds are really on doing a lot of things with regards to health and hygiene a bit better. And of course, I think most of us are a lot more conscientious about washing our hands or using hand sanitizer, and we think that's very, very, very important. But if it would lead us to start hating one another or judging one another, then it's a tradition or a rule that somehow has to be looked at. Of course, it's always important to wash our hands, but when the attitude comes in that it has to be done in a certain way, that's when I think God probably shakes his head. The early Jews were devoted to the Mishnah, and that was an interpretation of Moses' law, how to keep them and how to break them. And with regards to washing your hands, as I said in the children's lesson, there's a ceremonial way of doing it, whether your hands are dirty or not, and fingertips up and then fingertips down and so forth. The Pharisees were totally bent out of shape that Jesus' disciples weren't washing their hands in the right way. Now, it says in the Bible that they just weren't washing their hands, but it had to do with how they were washing their hands. Jesus knew that this wasn't a good religious tradition. Why? Because the focus was all wrong. If the ceremonial cleansing helped to get people to think about good hygiene and to avoid diseases, then maybe, yes, that's a good tradition. As a matter of fact, that's the way why the rule came up to begin with. These rules, these cleanliness laws, came when Moses was bringing the people through the Promised Land. And they were trying to avoid diseases. They were trying to stay healthy, and they didn't understand necessarily how diseases and illnesses would come and go. And so they had a very particular way of keeping clean. And it was to protect all of them until they got into the Promised Land. But 1,000 years later, the question is, do they still have to do it that way, or washing your hands in any way, is that okay? Well, it pointed people, this particular way of judging, to the rigidity of rules, and this tradition is just meant, it seemed, for judging others. They were following tradition for tradition's sake rather than because it enhanced their faith in God and helped them to love one another. Now, Jesus, in our gospel lesson, and it's true for us today, Jesus is so much more concerned about our heart condition, not our hand condition, right? Jesus is more concerned about our heart condition rather than our hand condition. That's why Jesus called the Pharisees hypocrites, doing one thing with their lips, talking the talk, but not walking the walk. They were doing things with hands and lips, but not with their hearts. And that could be an issue for us today, too. And we need to look at our lives here a little bit. What our personal rules and traditions at home and in our community and at church and at school that cause us to judge one another and look down at one another and separate us from one another. A good religious tradition is one that always points us to Christ. That's the goal. Is our heart opened to God, and is our heart open to love one another through these traditions? If not, we need to relook at it. One example of just a good tradition is the Lord's Prayer. We say the Lord's Prayer every single Sunday, almost. Now, it's not a good tradition if the Lord's Prayer only signaled the end of the service. Oh, Lord's Prayer is coming, let's pack up our stuff. Or if the Lord's Prayer was only said so that, you just mutter the words because we always do. It's a good tradition if we really think about what we're saying in the Lord's Prayer and what each part is saying. We ask ourselves when we pray, am I doing his will? Am I living in such a way that brings his kingdom? Am I forgiving others? And do I recognize how God is forgiving me? Am I practicing his power and strength in resisting temptation? then the Lord's tradition, doing it every Sunday, is a good tradition. It helps us to love God and love others more. It's a prayer that's 2,000 years old, but it's good and relevant and good today. Well, that was a church example. There are other examples at school and community and so forth. But the faith lesson for us today is this. Let's not be hypocrites by judging others who don't act or look or do things the way that we do or the way that we interpret life. Let's remember what the Bible says in 1 Chronicles 16. The eyes of the Lord roam upon the entire earth looking for those hearts that are true to him. God is so much more concerned about your heart condition than your hands condition. And you never know. I don't know. Maybe the next time we come to church, you'll all be sitting in different places.
Come live in the light, shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Come, open your heart, show your mercy to all those in fear. We are called to be hope for the hopeless, to hatred and blindness will be no more. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Sing, sing a new song. Sing of the great day when all will be one. God will reign and we'll walk with each other as sisters and brothers, united in love. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God.
If you feel comfortable, I invite you to stand for the prayers. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Oh God, today we pray for your church universal, that it is a safe haven for all who seek your presence. Fill your church throughout the world with pastors and deacons and leaders and volunteers who echo your expansive and generous welcome. Lord, in your mercy. God, we pray for the whole creation that you've made, that plants and animals have the habitat and resources to thrive and flourish. Inspire us to protect threatened habitats and ensure a sustainable future for generations to come. Lord, bring rain where it's needed, and sunshine and dry weather where it's needed. Calm the storms that destroyed land and livelihood. We pray particularly for those places in the south ravaged by floods and the storm that's about to hit our southern coast. Lord, push the storm back. May it diminish. We pray for those, even in our state, affected by forest fires. God, send that land rain. And God, we pray for seasonable weather, and we thank you that how you have provided for us, Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for individuals in positions of authority. Raise up wise and discerning leaders in federal, state, and local governments. Guide them to seek the benefit of every person, Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for all who are in need. Support and encourage those who are unemployed or underemployed, those experiencing poverty or hunger, those who need shelter and clothing and stability for their daily life. Lord, for those close to home and needing an extra measure of your healing, we lift up to you Russ Bullion, Herb Dileski, Brady Nelson, Jim P., Virginia Thoe and Cheryl Herrick, Nicole Sheff, Patty Rood, Donna Jorgensen, Jana Wagner, Joey Sandvik. Lord, in each of their conditions, bring them healing and hope. And now, Lord, we lift up to you others that we now name in our hearts. And Lord God, we pray for all who are in our nursing homes and care centers. We pray, Lord, for those serving in the military. Lord, we lift up to you those in danger's way in Afghanistan and other places in the world. God, may your kingdom come through all that your people are doing. Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, we pray for this congregation, especially those beginning a new school year, the students and teachers and other leaders and helpers. Empower teachers and school administrators. Guide students in their learning and in their development. Accompany parents and foster parents and caregivers who provide encouragement and love. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And I receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing two verses of Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. While the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love, teach me ever to adore thee. May I still thy goodness prove. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.